Hallelujah. Psalm 71, verses 6, the Bible said in the word of the Lord, by thee have I been held up from the womb. It is you that brought me out of my mother's bowels, and my praise shall continually be of thee. Then in verses 8, the Bible said, I will praise you all the day long. Praise God all my life. My mouth will be heard giving your praise. Somebody say, birthing praise. I ain't really heard much of that this morning because I was doing one of the hardest things I've ever done in church this morning. I was sitting back there communicating with people on the live stream. Amen. But God told me, he said, don't say a word. Now, friend, God don't usually tell me not say a word. But God told me, he said, don't say a word and listen how quiet it is when your mouth's not hurt. Hello? We're not here to watch Marvin Booth on the platform. My voice shouldn't be the only one heard saying, amen, thank you, Jesus, praise the Lord. And you know who should have been heard first? Men, not women. Because David's the one saying it was God that brought me out of my mother's bowels. It was God. You thought the doctor delivered you? Uh-uh. The Lord delivered you. Every one of you, amen, were delivered personally by the Lord Jesus himself. The one that put you inside of your mother's womb is the one that delivered you whenever you were delivered. How many ever years ago it was? Come on, somebody. He's the one that delivered you from your mother's womb. And David said, I'm going to praise him. Somebody say, perpetually, continually. Then he said, all the days I live, my mouth. Somebody look at your neighbor and say, your mouth. Your mouth. He said, my mouth shall be heard. Look at somebody and tell them, say, the womb of your mouth where something is birthed. It's called praise to God. Hey man, it opens. You might be a man this morning, but in the spirit, somebody shouts, you got to turn into a midwife of praise. You got to open your mouth and birth your best praise to him. Somebody say, welcome to a birthing place. Welcome to a place, amen, where we come to praise the one that not only brought us out of our mother's womb, but however long ago it was when we by the Spirit were born again. Come on, somebody. We ought to be doubly praising him for not just a first birth, but a second birth. Men should be heard first. Women should also be heard. Somebody say, giving him praise, giving him glory, giving him honor. Somebody say, by thee have I been brought out of my mother's womb, and my praise shall continually be of thee. And he said, all the day long, somebody say, all my life, my mouth will be heard giving God praise. And some of you still ain't did it. I question whether you know him or not. Come on, anybody hear the Holy Ghost? If you can't praise him for your first birth, surely if you're born again, you ought to be able to praise him for your second birth. Somebody say, birth and praise. On this Mother's Day, oh, this is a delivery room. Somebody shout, he's too worthy for me to hold my peace. He's too worthy, amen, for me to keep my lips sealed, amen, and my mouth shut. Come on, give him praise today. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy. Whoa, this woman at the well, somebody say she was a no name. Somebody say, this ain't about our fame and our name. I said, Holy Ghost, you didn't even give her a name. You didn't even tell us who she was, because the only name that was worthy of mentioning in the story was not the five men that she had already been married to and the number six man that she'd just left the bedroom with that she weren't married to. Amen. And it weren't even her name that was important. Somebody shout, there was one man sitting on Jacob's well. Oh, this was Jesus, and his name is the only worthy one of the story. Hey, look at somebody beside you. Tell them, say, it don't matter what your name was remembered for, because you still a no name. Somebody say, I've been called by his name. Jeremiah 15, 16. You may have been a woman of the night. You may have been a woman of sin, a man of sin, a woman of adultery, a man of adultery, a woman of the world. world, man of the world. But somebody shout when you meet this Jesus. It don't matter what your name was. It don't matter who you were called. Somebody shout when you call on him. He changes you from the inside out. Because in John 4:10, Jesus said, woman, if you knew the gift of God and who it is that's speaking to you, you'd ask him for a drink. And he wouldn't just give you any water. This wouldn't be DeSante. Amen. Aquafina. This wouldn't be any other kind of spring water. Amen. Even tap water. Somebody shout living water. And the well wouldn't be the one you're looking at called Jacob's. The well would be on the inside of you. You've heard of Jonah in the well. This is a different well. This is Jesus in the well. Everybody go, well, this is where you get well at. This is where you get whole at. There ain't but one thirst quencher. His name's Jesus. Brother Marvin, you don't know what I did. You don't know where I've been and what I was doing with who I was with. He does, and is still a wait on you. He'll still sit in a well. He'll still sit in a place when everybody else has gone away. Come on, because they can't save you anyhow. This woman come at the time of day when all the other women she knew wouldn't be there, because she felt so unworthy, so condemned, come on, so nasty and ashamed. But while the disciples were going to town to eat, ain't that just like it did modernly? Somebody said church is chicken. Amen. They all went to eat them a chicken leg, I guess. I don't know what they went to eat, but they went to eat, and Jesus sat there fasting. Somebody shout in John 4, Jesus was fasting for one woman. It starts off in John 4:4, said, I must needs go through Samaria. Samaria was a people, not just a place, not just a nation, but a people, amen, that strived against the Jews. Amen. There was racial discord. Amen. They had nothing in agreement concerning God. But ain't that like Jesus? I'll go get somebody, amen, nobody else wants to get. I'll go reach out to somebody nobody else will reach out to. Can you praise him yet? Amen. Folks didn't look at you. Folks in the church world said they ain't worthy enough. Folks, religious folks said they're not even worth the time of day. But didn't Jesus come sit on the well of your life? He said somewhere you walked in and your well was a bar stool and you found him. Amen. You felt conviction even in the darkest places, even in the deepest places of sin. That's where you found him. Oh, come on. Going to get a drink or whatever. Going to get a toke or whatever. Come on, somebody. He met you right in the middle of your sin. And he's a real prophet. She said, I perceive you a prophet. How did she perceive he was a prophet? Because he said, you have said, well, you have no husband. Because you've been married 5 times. And the one man you just left, you ain't married to him either. She said, sir, I perceive you to be a prophet. But Jesus didn't want her to just know him as sir. There's a lot of people today religiously, they only know him as a religious sir, just a God that they need when they in times of trouble. But Jesus was wanting her to leave the well that day and not just know him as sir, but as her savior. And she didn't just come to church, let's preach it that way, and leave knowing him as sir with a respect. Because to call somebody sir, somebody shout, that's showing respect. That's a display of respect. But God said, I don't want you to just respect me. I want you to have a relationship with me. And she didn't just leave calling him sir. She left saying, come and see a Messiah. He's the sent one. That was her confession. He's the Savior. And she left that well a different woman that day. Brother Martin, what's that got to do with Mother's Day? John 4:39, and many of the Samaritans of the city believed on him for the saying of the woman which testified, he told me all I ever did. Remember, her confession was, you got to be a real prophet because you told me my sin. Somebody say, real prophets will tell you your sin. Real prophets, they'll convict you with the words out of their mouth of the wrongdoing you're doing. They won't patticate it. They won't sugarcoat it. Sugar-free, right here it is. Anybody hear the Holy Ghost? Somebody say, Jesus loved her so much, he told her all she ever did. But at the same time he was telling her all she ever did, he said, I got a gift for you called eternal water, eternal life. It'll spring up in you as a well. Girl, you can leave this well and have a well, an inward well. This is an outside well. All the women got to go out of town. They got to go somewhere to try to get some water from somewhere else. But I'll give you an eternal, internal, amen, spring. And it's me. Oh, anybody hear the Holy Ghost? What that man couldn't do for you last night, I'm the one that can meet your need in that longing. Somebody shout, there ain't enough of men. There ain't enough of women to fix what's wrong with you or with me. There's no relationship in this life that even comes close to a relationship with him. She left there that day saying, finally, I'll know what it means to be satisfied, to be filled. And I met a man who didn't want me to take my clothes off. I met a man that accepted me as I am and changed me into another woman. And she went from being a prostitute to a preacher in one evening. And though it says no, it does not say she birthed any child naturally in this story. I'm sure she had if she'd been that kind of lady. Hello? Hello? There weren't much what you would say back then as far as birth control. So I'm sure she probably birthed several children with the lifestyle she was living sexually. But listen, she birthed the whole city that day. Somebody say she brought forth. That's a term used for birthing. Somebody say she brought forth many to him. Somebody look at your neighbor. Say a spiritual mother. Oh, glory. She became a spiritual mama that day to the whole city of Samaritans that were lost and on their way to hell. She came to a well and saved many from hell. And it weren't Jacob's well. It was Jesus the well. She got a well in inside of her. Somebody say, we don't know her name because it weren't about her. It was about him. And it said the whole city believed on him. She gave birth to many. She brought many to Jesus. Somebody say the second birth in this story. Say that again. Many. Somebody say many Samaritans of that city. Somebody say they believed on Jesus because of what she said to him. The sin of the woman. He told me all I ever did. And then it says later on that they came to him and many more believed because of his own words. In other words, she brought them to Jesus because of her one moment, her experience, and beyond a moment and experience, somebody say, her encounter of a relationship with Jesus Christ. God transformed that woman of sin into a woman of salvation. And God didn't send her to a school of theology for 10 weeks or 10 months. Somebody say the same afternoon she got saved. Amen. She got pregnant at that well with a gift from God, with an anointing, with a calling. Somebody shouting in that moment, she was qualified to go tell folks about the one she had met. And because of that, somebody shout, a heathen city turned into a new birth center. Come on, somebody. And people came to the Lord. I'm going to tell you, mama, amen, you may be a mama because you birth children in the flesh, but I want to tell you today, if you're going to birth, amen, children in the spirit, and this ain't just for women, this is for men too, you got to have you a real living well experience with the Savior Jesus Christ. Somebody shout, God didn't save me and just leave it at that. He saved me so I could go do what this woman did and go bring others to him. Somebody say, that's what a spiritual mother is. How spiritual are you, mama? I know you're responsible to rear and train up your biological children, your flesh and blood. But listen, older women, your Bible tells you you're supposed to be taking younger women and training them. Hey, elderly ladies, how many younger women do you got up under the wing of your prayer? How many are you reaching out to? Same with men. Come on, you older men, how many young men are you grabbing hold of? Amen, to teach the word, or do you just come to church for you? Or do you just go to the altar for you and what you need from God? Anybody hear the Holy Ghost? The younger women's going to know how to do this. They got to learn from you. Amen, but how can they learn from you if you don't have no burn, no desire for them? Anybody hear the Holy Ghost? Somebody shout, she left the well and didn't go back home and say, well, I'm saved. No, you know what it says? It says she went through the city and told all the men. It don't say this, amen, but I believe she went and told six men first. Can you imagine her walking in the room of all six of them men and they sitting at the table with their wife and children? Hey, my God. Anybody hear the Holy Ghost? Somebody shout, that's what happens when you really get saved. You ain't afraid to tell folks what you did. But thank God, what I did, I don't do no more. Jesus, amen, saved her. Somebody shout, it don't record she ever went back to prostitution. She didn't go back to what she had been living in. Somebody shout, she was winning and birthing others to Christ. And this is not a question just for women and ladies, but for men too. You gonna be a spiritual mother? You gonna be a spiritual father? Hello? Who are you birthing into the kingdom? Who are you going and sharing him with? Hello? Somebody say, you can't meet him at a well and keep that to yourself. If you can keep this to yourself, you ain't met him yet. Amen. Matthew 10 and 8 says, cleanse the leper, heal the sick, raise the dead, cast out devils. Somebody say, freely you receive, freely you give. Somebody say, if you hadn't received this, you can't give what you've not received. Anybody hear the Holy Ghost? Well, I can talk about my fishing story. Well, I can talk about my hunting story. Come on, somebody. I can talk about the job. I can talk about the work. I can talk about the schedule of life. Oh, I can talk about the ball game. Score. I can talk about the team I like. I can do all this talking, but somebody shout, if you got a not just a real but a well experience with Jesus like this woman, somebody say, you'll be finding you somebody. It'll become your conversation. Philippians 1:27, amen, says, let your conversation become as it becomes the gospel of Christ. Somebody say, no matter where you go, you got to tell somebody. You got to let somebody know. Somebody shout, that's how you birth souls into the kingdom. But it starts in here. If you can't birth a praise to him for your first birth and your own second birth that you've had an experience with him in, how in the world are you going to be able to open the womb of your mouth? Amen. Come on, somebody, and birth through the matrix of your mouth a testimony to somebody else that don't know him. Somebody look at your neighbor and say, God's calling everybody, both sexes, because he didn't make but two, and that's male and female. He's calling us into a birthing position. He's calling us today to birth his praise. To birth, open our mouth and praise him, because he brought you out of your mama's womb and he brought you a second time. He brought you out of your sin. He brought you out of your bondage. You've been born again, and he's saying, I need you to turn into this mother mentality in the sense of the spirit and begin to open your mouth and give birth to my praise and my gospel and go share me with somebody. So they may too be like in this storyline, those that come to him because of one woman. Don't tell me one person can't make a difference. One woman met one the man. Oh, she met me, and I'm talking about the man. And she turned the whole city upside down. She won, I don't know how many means, but this is a city, so we're talking about hundreds of people. In one afternoon, she wins. Somebody said, that's revival. Jesus fasted and prayed one afternoon, and a revival through one woman hit the whole city just like that. While the disciples was going to town to eat, where some of you done thought about going 10 to 12 times while this whole service been going. Anybody hear the Holy Ghost? See, y'all don't know how to say amen on that. I watch heads go like that. Hallelujah. Do it again. I'll preach it again. Maybe it's 15 times you thought about it instead of 10 or 12. Hallelujah. God told me to do something. I'm going to say it again. Hardest thing I ever had to do in church service. He said, just sit back there and work your thumbs and communicate with folks on live stream. He said, but don't say a word and watch how quiet it gets. The more it went on, the more nervous I got.
the more deeper it bothered me in the spirit. And I kept hearing Psalm 71, 6 and Psalm 71 and 8. Marvin, I brought you out of your mother's womb. You ought to praise me for that. Here on this Mother's Day, you ought to praise God for your mama. You ought to tell your mama she's still alive. Thank you for birthing me. But beyond that, it's the Lord's Day, not just Mother's Day. You ought to be praising God. Come on. If you've told your mama thank you this morning and loved on her, good for you. But you ain't fulfilled your obligation. Amen. Today, unless you've opened your mouth, lifted your hands, stood to your feet, done something as an act of faith, in praise to the one that birthed you out, brought you out of your mother's womb. How old are you? It was that long ago. God brought you from your mama's womb. And how long ago has it been since you were born again? Your praise ought to be louder than that it is about your first birth. Amen. David said, all the day long while I live, my mouth is going to be heard giving you thanks. Psalms 34 verse 1 said, bless the Lord, O my soul. Those within may bless his holy name. That's Psalms 103 verse 1. Let's go back to Psalms 34 and 1. He said, I'll bless the Lord at all times. Somebody say his praise. Somebody say his praise. Not mine. Remember, she's a no name. We ain't praising her. Somebody say his praise shall continually. Somebody say that means around the clock. Come on, somebody. Well, brother, you ought to hear me praising God in the cab of my car. I didn't hear you praising him in church this morning. Ain't nobody get loud in here. Oh, I heard a few whispers of amen. Oh, yeah, pray. Oh, yeah. No. I'm talking about when they watch it on live stream, they ought to hear and distinguish your voice over this microphone, not just mine. Anybody hear the Holy Ghost? Y'all hear how loud it's gotten here already now? Why? Because I got the microphone. But that shouldn't be the case. Have I offended you enough yet to get you to repent that you've been missing God for the first 32 minutes of this service? You have sit there in silence. Every now and then, some of you men, I rebuke you here on this Mother's Day. How in the world you leading your house if you can't even come in God? Your children ought to know how to praise God, not from watching your wife, but from watching you. They ought to know how to follow God to the house of God and in the spirit to the altar, not by watching your wife, but you. Have I made you mad yet? I hope I have. I hope I snatch you out of your complacency. Lynn said it. She didn't know she said it, but she said the woman in the well. Amen. She meant at the well. She did most of the time, but one time she said in the well. And the Lord said that were no mistake. He said, because some of them, that's where they. Behold, it was Joseph, my servant, who was thrown in a well that was empty and dry and dark. And it was his elder brother, says the Spirit of Truth, whose name is Judah, that stood in the proxy, the gap for him, and rescued him from that dry, deep, dark well. For he said to his brethren, let us not kill and murder our own flesh and blood, but let's take him out of this well, and we'll sell him to the Midianites. Behold, I say unto you, Judah, whose name means praise. Praise is who Judah is. Judah rescued Joseph from that deep, dark, waterless well. And behold, I say unto you this day, it is I, saith the Lord, that am the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Lion of praise. You're in a well. You're in a pitfall. You're in a dry, dark place. Hear me, saith the Holy Ghost. I'm pouring the water of my word in you, and I'm waiting for a response, says God. Can I stir you up to a praise? Can I get you to open your mouth and birth Judah? Because when you do, says the Spirit of the Lord, I'll do for you what I did with Joseph. I'll bring you up out of that deep, dark, dry well, says the Holy Ghost. Oh, hallelujah. You know who gave birth to Judah? Genesis 29. Welcome to Acts 29. Might as well preach from Genesis 29 for a moment. There was a woman named Leah. The Bible said
that her eyes were heavy. She had a little lazy eye. One of them was a droop. Hello? Leah weren't considered your, you know, prominent, you know, one to, many would say, well, she could be a great looker. She could be, you know, the one that could be the movie star in that culture. And she had a younger sister named Rachel. Rachel's name means a young, beautiful lamb. Hello? Rachel was considered what they called the beautiful one. Leah was not such the one. Leah's name in Hebrew means wild cow. How would you like your daddy to name you? Now, if you're watching and your name's Leah, that don't mean it means this way in English. In Hebrew, Leah meant wild cow. Can you see him? Here comes Leah. Well, I told you until the cows come home. Hello? She marries Jacob. Now, this is the well Jesus is sitting at in John 4, so it's all connected. But she's deceived into marrying Jacob. Jacob told her father, Laban, I'll work 7 years for Rachel. When he saw Rachel the first time at the well, this same well Jesus is sitting at hundreds of years later, he sees Rachel come to that same well, another woman at this well. And Jacob lifts up his eyes and starts crying. Somehow say that boy is struck with love at first sight. Somebody say this same well, Jacob's well, this same well you find hundreds of years later where Jesus is winning this woman to him. Because it's Jacob's well now. And Rachel, he wants to marry her. Somebody say he loves her so much he's willing to work 7 years before he can marry her. Somebody say true love will go to work. Well, Brother Marvin, he loves me, but he won't work. You're the only one that works. He won't worry. He won't sit at the house and play game station and sleep to noon. He don't love you. Then comes the marriage. And back then, the women were veiled before marriage. That means their head was covered. During the marriage, and on their way to the honeymoon, they were covered from top to feet. And in the dark, the veil was removed. Jacob, listen to this now. He woke up the next morning. He thought he'd been on a honeymoon, but when daylight hit and she removed, he removed the veil. Hello? Stay in the spirit. Don't get offended. Hello? Hallelujah. He removed the veil, and to his shock, it was Leah. It weren't young, beautiful lamb. It was wild cow. Hello? He was mad, furious, and shocked all at the same time. Somebody say his honeymoon turned into a honeydoom. It don't matter. She was the most beautiful woman in the world. He was in love with Rachel until wake up with another woman and had been deceived by their father. You'd be a little upset as well. Can't you imagine how Leah felt having to be quiet the whole time? Oh, glory. Then he comes to Laban. He's mad. And Laban says, well, I need you to work 7 more years for me. 14 altogether. And then you have Rachel. He was so in love, he said, I'll work 7 more years. Then he marries Rachel. But the entire time they're married, because back then they could be married more than one. Thank God, God revised that. Hello, no longer is that acceptable. Come on, anybody here, Holy Ghost? I don't care what church and religion you're a part of. The New Testament God of Christianity now. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. Even before the cross. Come on, somebody. Amen. That is no longer the case. But I'm not going to get into all that. But now he's got Leah and he's got Rachel, two sisters. He's married to them. Amen. Leah could have been named Myrtle because she was fertile. Man, she was having babies left and right, but Rachel was barren. She couldn't have no children. Even in Genesis 30 verse 1, it records Rachel praying, said, give me children lest I die. Well, let's get back to the spiritual motherhood. Come on, the church better get to being like that. The church better learn how to be a mother church. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. That lets this becomes a birthing place. Amen. It should be at the top of our cry to God, the top of our prayer list in the altars. We should always have an excuse. God, give us children lest the church dies. Give us new birth. Give us people born again. Born of the Spirit, born into the kingdom of God. But for her case, it was that was of the flesh. Give me children lest I die. Because back then, for a woman not to be able to bear a child, that was considered a curse. They were treated second rate. So God told Leah, he said, because you've been hated, despised, looked down upon, I have opened your womb to bear children. The Bible talks about different sons she had. I'm going to read it. Y'all okay with that? I got a Bible somewhere around here. Hallelujah. It was camouflaged. Couldn't see it. Hold on. Hallelujah. In Genesis chapter 29, I'm going to read some of her sons and their names and tell you what God is saying to us this morning. And it all connects with everything we've been saying about birth and praise for the two births. Come on, somebody, in the spiritual motherhood and what he's saying to us in the spirit, because God just prophesied, because that's what, amen, interpretation of tongues is equivalent to according to the scripture. Somebody say God just spoke to us and said in reference, and you'll find that in Genesis 37 through 39, you'll find God rescuing Joseph out of a deep, dark pit empty of water by his eldest brother Judah, the man we're about to preach that Leah gave birth to as her last son. And we're going to tell you what all that translates to. And somebody say, it's all taking place. It's all because of one well. Hundreds of years before Jesus sat on a well and won a prostitute to himself and the whole city got saved, she became a spiritual mother. Amen. We find the man Jacob at this well, falling in love with Rachel, and he's married now deceptively to Leah. Amen. And now agreeably to Rachel. Praise God. And we see the circumstances that surrounding that, but see it in the spirit with us. Hallelujah. You know, in verses 11 of Genesis 29, remember Jacob, when he didn't just see Rachel at that well, he kissed her, and somebody say, lifted up his voice and he cried. He began to cry. He had it bad. Somebody say he had it bad. Amen. So I've told you the storyline of how that happened, and so how Laban beguiled Jacob into marrying Leah first. Praise God. Amen. And then so it says in verse 30 of Genesis 29, and he went in also unto Rachel, and he loved also Rachel more than Leah, and served with him yet 7 other years. And when the Lord saw that Leah was hated, he opened her womb, but Rachel was barren. It said in verse 32 of Genesis 29, and Leah conceived and bare a son, and she called his name Reuben. Somebody say Reuben. She said, surely the Lord has looked upon my affliction. Now therefore will my husband love me. Reuben's name means, amen, to look upon, to see. In other words, she said, now I've birthed to my husband Jacob, amen, a son. I'm going to call him Reuben. Now he'll look at me like he does my sister. Now he'll be attracted to me. He'll look at me with love. He'll notice me. Somebody say, he'll notice me. Remember that. And then her next son, she conceives again and bears a son, and said, because the Lord hath heard that I was hated, he hath therefore given me a son and called his name Simeon. Simeon means to hear, hearing. Amen. Remember the man Simeon in the Bible in Luke 2 that prophesied over the 8-day-old baby of Jesus. Come on, somebody. Same name. Somebody say to hear. In other words, she said, God has seen my affliction. My son Reuben, and my first son to Jacob, amen, now my husband will notice me. He'll see me for who I am. He'll love me the same. Amen. And then she has her next son, and she calls his name again Simeon. Now, amen, Jacob will hear me. Now he'll pay attention to me. He'll listen to me. We'll have a communion of fellowship because God seen that I was hated. And then she has her third son. She conceived again and bare a son. And now this time she said, will my husband be joined to me because I have borne him 3 sons. She called his name Levi. Levi means to be joined to. She said, here I am the whole time. I'm birthing babies for Jacob because I'm trying to get him to look at me the way he does, my sister. I'm trying to get him to notice me. Amen. She had her son Reuben. Now he'll hear me. Now he'll talk with me. Now he'll listen to me. Hallelujah. Amen. I'll have his attention. Amen. And then she has her third son. I'm going to call him Levi. Amen. Because now my husband will really be connected to me, joined to me. Somebody say the whole time she was trying to get affection from a man. She was trying to get her fulfillment from her husband. And she kept coming up short. Come on. Anybody hear the Holy Ghost? Don't you know that woman hundreds of years later
her at the same well, at Jacob's well. She done tried so many men and was still coming up empty, still coming up thirsty. That's why Jesus said, if you drink here again, girl, you still gonna be thirsty. You still gonna need you another man. You still gonna need somebody different. But you ain't gotta look no further, because I am the man, the Son of Man, the Son of God. And if you'll drink from me, this relationship will provide all the sustenance, all the sustaining strength you would ever need. No matter if there's no Jacob around that'll notice you, that'll listen to you, or even connect or stay with you. To join with somebody means to stay with him. Now he'll stay with me. She's worried about he's going to leave. Then old Fertile Myrtle, Sister Leah, somebody to say she bears a fourth son. And she conceived again and bare him. And she said, now will I praise the Lord. This is verse 35 of Genesis 29. Therefore she called his name Judah. Listen to this. And she left barren. Now that ain't B-A-R-R-N. E-N, I mean. That's B-E-A-R-I-N-G. Somebody say she left barren the pain of birthing. Somebody say she left her birth pains. Somebody say she left the travail. She left. Some of you think birth pains just when a woman is giving birth to a child, but yet when you look around in life and you can't find nobody that'll notice you, can you imagine at the sins and the things people are doing, trying to get somebody to notice them, trying to get somebody's applause, trying to get a daddy's pat on the back, daddy boy, amen, a dad on the back, daddy girl, amen, trying to find, amen, in a husband, amen, that'll celebrate you, see you, notice you, listen to you, connect to you, and not feel threatened that they're going to run out on you every time you don't live up or measure up. Somebody say she's wore out. Not just from birthing babies in the flesh. Somebody say the whole time she's been carrying a travail in the spirit. She said, you know what? I'm going to name this boy Judah. His name means praise the Lord. Why? Because I ain't worried about Jacob no more. I've went to Jacob's well over and over and over. I've been going like this woman to Jacob's well again and again. And nobody, though they notice me, they may notice me for a night, but then they forget me the next day. They may listen to me at night, but come morning, they gone listening for somebody else. And by the time I think they with me, here they go and they leave me again. She said, you know what? I ain't wasting my time with Jacob's well. I'm going to get the one who sat on Jacob's well, and I'm going to praise him. I'm going to name this child Judah. And somebody say, when she birthed Judah, she left her pain. That's what happened hundreds of years later with another woman at the well. At Jacob's well, she left her pain at Jacob's well, because she met Jesus at that well. Somebody say she traded Jacob for Jesus. Some of you, I don't know where it is you're looking and who you're trying to get to look to you. You're trying to find a Levi, somebody to join to you, you can depend on and trust in. Amen. But flesh and blood will break your heart. I don't care who they are. Oh, anybody here, they'll let you down every time. Oh, glory to God. You may be trying to find you a Reuben, somebody to just listen to you, but you can't find them. Amen. And by the time you think you do, where did they go? Amen. You ain't listening to me. Glory to God. You may be looking for you. That's Simon. That's Simeon. And you may be looking for a Reuben, trying to get somebody to notice me. Notice me. Notice more what I'm going. Does anybody know what I'm going through? Everybody look at your neighbor and say, there's one that always does. Tell him, say, he's looking on you. He notices you. Somebody shout, he's listening to you. You got his ear. Man may come, man probably will go, but he said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you, that you may say boldly, the Lord's my helper, I'll not fear. What can a man do unto me? Hebrews 13 verse 5 and 6. Levi, he may join to you for a moment, especially when you're preaching to him what he wants to hear, We've had a lot of Levi's around here. Oh, Brother Marvin, I'm with you, son. I've had them stand right here with microphones in their hand, and what's so sad, I got them on video to prove it. I'm not making this stuff up. If I was really mean-spirited, I could pull back old videos. I got every one of them. I've heard them stand right here and say, I'm talking about days and hours and weeks before they forsook. We're here for the long haul. God told us, God said. I've had them stand here on this platform. I've had them stand in places behind here on this property and say, Brother Marvin, whatever God tells to you, you tell me. It don't matter if it hurts my feelings, because I'm here for the real word of God. And as long as I was telling somebody else, they were shouting loud. Oh, they sounded like a real dedicated Levi. A Levi. They was wearing Levi's. That's about all they was in as far as a Levi spirit. Amen. But as soon as I had to look at them and say, it's you, like Nathan did to David, and say, you're the man. You're the one. You need to get that right. You need to. As soon as I began to say, you. They're no longer joined to you. But somebody say, there's only one. That's why you can't afford to sit there. Somebody say, this ain't ceremony, this is church. Well, the church forsook me. The domination forsook me. The ministers turned their back on me. Let me tell you about one that didn't turn his back on you, but he turned his back to a cross for you. You ought to birth some Judah. You better pull out your praise, Leah. You better stop worrying about who is and who's not and who was and who won't. Come on. If Jesus be for you, if God be for you, who can be against you? Romans 8:37. Somebody say, leave that pain. Praise him. Leave the pain. Praise him. Praise him. Praise him. Brianna, will you come sing that? By Sherry Easter. Somebody say, leave the pain. Praise him. Birth Judah here on this Mother's Day. Some of you, you're grieving over somebody who's left you through neglect. They broke their covenant with you, whether it was a marriage covenant or whether it was a covenant in the spirit in ministry. Somebody say, all covenant breaking hurts. It hurts. When somebody's joined together and you amputate something, even when they have to cut something off of you, it hurts until it heals. Somebody say, this is how you get healed. You get your focus off of Jacob's well, and you get your focus on the one who sat on Jacob's well, Jesus Christ. Amen. And you give birth to some Judah. You praise him that he's the one that created you. He brought you out of your mama's womb, but he's the one that saved your soul from hell. Oh, glory to God. Don't you fall over in Jacob's well today. That's where somebody's at. That's why you've become silent. That's why you ain't got no shout no more. You've been looking to this one and that one, and some are still longing for what left them and what betrayed them and what hurt them. But God says, I didn't leave you. I didn't go away from you. I'm still here. When the church went to the city to buy something to eat, Jesus stayed at the well. Somebody shout, the whole church can leave you, but if he's still there, drink this living water and leave that barren place. Leave that dark, dry place. Let Judah bring you up out. Let Judah, I'm going to get another microphone. You can use this one. I'll bring you that too. When all things fall apart, praise his name.
Seems so tall, and you realize life is not always fair. You let the old man decide. You can change your circumstances with a prayer. Everything falls apart. Praise his name when you have a broken heart. Just raise your hands and say, Lord, you're all I need. You're everything to me, and he can take the pain away.
Come on, leave the pain and birth some praise of you.
You're all alone. Praise his name when you feel you can't go on. Just raise your hands and say,
talking loud to you today. Come on, this is a birthing altar today. Come birth Judah and leave the pain, Leah. Somebody was going to shovel dirt over you, but not so, because I'm bringing you out. Yes! Woo! Thank you, Holy Ghost. Y'all do me a favor. Come to the altar. Don't just come to the aisle in the wall. Don't be afraid to get up here to this altar. If you can't get to the altar from over there, please come up to this altar. We ain't got to run through people to get to you. Come on over here to the altar. There's plenty of room. You to leave the pain. Leave the past. Don't be a shy approaching God. Be come to Him. Yes.
Your mountain seems
Lord,
so
heal,
tall.
I pray right now in Jesus' name.
You realize life is not always
don't run away.
You
lift your hands up in that deep, dry well and praise Him and give birth to Judah. Because in your birth in Judah, you leave the barren, the childbearing pain, the travail of your soul. Of Jesus. Oh, boy, did God talk loud to you today. He didn't leave you. He didn't leave you. Holy. Now, Holy Ghost.
Praise His name. When you feel you can't go on, just raise your hands and say,
thank you, Holy Ghost. Greater is He.
Yes,
within me.
You can praise the hurt.
You can praise the hurt.
If you'll just praise His name.
Sister Tammy, today God says, I'm bringing you out of that deep well, that dark place, and you're going to leave all that that was done. You're going to leave it at the bottom of this pit. And you're coming back out with praise. God says you've been there long enough. But today is your resurrection. All the pain and the hurt, God says, not let it be in your mouth again. Don't let it be spoken from your lips again. Leave it at the bottom of the well that I deliver you from this day. And get your harp out of the willow tree. Praise me, daughter. I gave you a praise. I gave you a praise. Many will hear. Just like this woman, many will hear your praise. And believe on me, says the Lord. Hallelujah. Raise your hands and say,
Lord, you're all I need.
Lord, you're all I need.
Everything to me.
You think I can't go no more, praise Him and you will.
And say, greater is He.
Greater is He.
That is within me. You can praise the hurt.
You can praise the hurt. Hallelujah.
Confess this day that you are healed. You'll always hurt, daughter, but you'll be one who hurts who is healed also. And it was only in me. This is why I dealt with you about this woman in the well. Not your husband. No one else. Not even the memories that are great and good can heal. But you have correctly confessed this day, because I have healed you. And you have confessed right. Thy son is also healed. Serve me and you'll see him again.
Lord, you're all I need.
It's proof you can come up here and sing if you've been up 20 hours straight.
The Holy Ghost.
I laugh when people tell me they're tired.
You're all alone.
Somehow those that's anointed live above such things.
When you feel you can't go on, just raise your hands and say.
I heard a voice tell me back there in the sound booth. He said, when your wife gets through, go dismiss the service, because they ain't here. They don't want to hear God. Listen to them. You don't even hear them. And I said, devil, I rebuke you, because the Lord told me to be quiet and listen, so I could come up here and without any rehearsal preach to you revelation. I have not studied what just come out of my mouth. Some still ain't obeyed, but some did, and that was what's worth it. Oh, hallelujah. You can overcome.
Oh, you can overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of your testimony. You'll see the darkness go.
Yeah, you won't see the darkness go.
Praise his name. But if you won't, you'll leave here in pain. If you won't do what God says to do. Amen. You know, Isaiah, you know, 2 Kings 18 and 3 says, the children have come to birth, but yet there's no strength to birth them. If you have sit here today and only heard this word and you hadn't acted on it, that means your time of birth had come, but you didn't act on it. Think about it. God says it's time to birth, but there's no strength to bring it forth. Somebody say, the Lord is my strength. His song, that means my praise, is my strength. Psalms 18 and 24. Somebody say, my song, my praise is my strength. A lot of people are at the brink of birthing. Bursting forth, breaking out of what they've been bound up with. But they just won't do what God says and go ahead and just that close. Just that close. Amen. And in John's writings, I believe it's 16, maybe verse 21, Jesus said, you know, a woman, when she has had travail, she does it with sorrow. And the lady said, amen. Why, her hour has come. Somebody say, the time of deliverance has come. Somebody say, when it's time to deliver, the sorrow increases. The travail increases. You know what we do in that moment? Women, you better start doing like you did in the birth room when you was giving birth in the flesh. You didn't sit there and say, well, I don't think I'll go to the altar. I don't think we need the doctor to come in. I just think I'll just lay here and just keep this baby in. Hello? And that was a puny attempt of trying to even, but I'm a man, so I can't even go there. I don't even know how to get alongside of you. No, I looked at Lynn, I said, baby, I'm with you. She looked at me, and if stairs could kill, I'd have died. All I could see on her look was, I'm laying here because of you. Get away from me. Hello? Get away from me. When a woman, when she has travail, she has sorrow. Somebody say, when it's time to birth something, there's sorrow everywhere. There's pain. It hurts. Why? Because her hour has come. Somebody say, you better recognize the hour of deliverance. We want it to be something that feels good. Mm-mm. But listen what happens. But as soon as she's delivered of a child, and Lynn even made reference to this earlier, she remembereth no more the anguish for the joy. Somebody say the joy. Somebody say the praise that a man or a child is born into the world. That's John 16 and 21. And Jesus spake in reference to his death on the cross like a woman travailing in pain and sorrow. Somebody say even the image of the cross was a birthing place of deliverance. Ladies, can y'all agree with that? When it's time, when your hours come to give birth, there's a lot of travail, a lot of pain, a lot of sorrow. But just as soon as baby gets put in mama's arms, you might be still in pain, but there's a joy that comes. There's a thankfulness. There's a joy that you didn't get in no other place. Your husband couldn't have gave you that joy. Come on, somebody. There's a, when you look at that precious baby's life that resembles both you and your husband, you holding that baby in your, there's a joy. Somebody's saying it's almost like the pain just disappears, even though you, it just don't matter like it did. And friend, we got to understand we're all pregnant with a praise. In the season of sorrow you end, that is so sorrowful and that is so travailing, that is your hour delivered. Somebody say, you must respect that moment and respond to it with a burst of joy and praise so God can birth. Somebody says the midwife of praise. You got a birth of praise. Come on, somebody, to come into that place that deliverance can take the place of all the sorrow. Oh, brother, I need me a garment of praise for this spirit of heaviness. Somebody say, even a garment, you have to go put it on. Isaiah 61 and 3 talks about, somebody say, put on a garment of praise. How many of you woke up this morning and you had some remote control you could mash and robots come and dressed you? Somebody say, you had to put your clothes on. One leg at a time, and ladies, one dress at a time. However you do that, because I ain't never tried it. And I won't be trying it no time soon or ever. Hallelujah. But you understand what I'm saying? Even praise. Oh, look at them people on camera. Look at them at that church down at Oxford. Look, I'm putting on. Thank you for the compliment. Because praise is what you put on. Somebody say, you make yourself. Psalms 100 verse 1 says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all you land. Somebody say, you make it. It ain't something that happens without you making it. Praise is an act of your faith. Somebody say, in the flesh. David danced before the Lord with all his might. 1 Samuel 6, verses 14. Somebody say, this is what you do when the sorrow's increased and the travail and the pain is at its worst. Somebody say, you birth some joy. You open your mouth and you give birth to praise. He's the God that brought me out of my mother's womb. My praise will be continually him. Psalm 71 and 6. Verse 8, all my days will I be heard with my mouth giving him praise all the day long. And most importantly, likewise in the presence of the angels of God as they're rejoicing over one sinner that repents. Luke 15 and 10. You may have been silent this morning because you forgot whose house you was in and what this day is all about. Come on, somebody. You may could have sit there and been quiet. I felt like you had to sneeze and you was trying to hold it back. That's what I felt like this morning, sitting back there not saying nothing. I felt like I was about to blow in too, but I had to do it on purpose because God was telling me, because I didn't know what I was coming up here to preach. I thought I did, but the Lord told me, he said, just forget all of that. Amen. I'm finna speak through you. And then it made sense why I was doing what I was doing. But somebody say, if you're going to get out of where you at, you're going to have to open your mouth. Praise has got to get out of your head and your heart and got to get back in your mouth. It's got to get back in your actions again. Why? Because the God that brought you out of your mother's womb, yeah, that's a great reason to praise him, because he's the one that delivered you the first time. But
celebrate your second deliverance. Come on, somebody, your second birth. Amen. If in the presence of the angels of God, there's rejoicing over one sinner that repents, that means angels are still singing songs about you when you got saved. And here you are silent about when he saved you. Somebody shout, if you can't sing, shout, stomp, dance, clap, open your mouth and do nothing but praise him over the second birth. Well, that's where Jesus said. The disciples had come back in verse 17 of Luke 10. They said, well, even demons are subject unto us through your name. And they were rejoicing. Somebody said they were excited. I've watched people get excited with me when we cast out demons here and only weeks later forsake us and the ministry and the Lord. That won't keep you. Jesus said, so what? I beheld Satan fall as lightning from heaven, Luke 10, 18. They was excited about casting demons out of people. And Jesus said, I'm the one who kicked him out of heaven. Why didn't you think in my name you couldn't kick him out of people? Hello? And you know what it says on in verses 19? He said, behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents, on scorpions, over all powers of the enemy. Nothing shall by any means hurt you. We love to hear about that power. He's about to tell us what the power is. He said in verse 20, but notwithstanding, don't rejoice because demons are subject unto you. Because there's going to be sometimes you pray in Jesus' name, seems like devils don't leave, seem like more come. Hello? The results ain't there, but that ain't where the root of my rejoicing's at. Listen, he said, don't rejoice because demons are subject unto you through my name, but rather rejoice because your name has been written in the book of life. Jesus said, that's real rejoicing. When you remember it was me, amen, that's the one that caused you to be born again. I delivered you a second time. I set you free. He said, that's where you should rather rejoice. You know what he did? Verse 21 of Luke 10, it said he rejoiced in the spirit for an hour. Somebody say, in the spirit. You know what real worship in the spirit, Lynn made mention of that, in spirit and truth, because in John 4 it ends with that, because Jesus is telling the woman, he just wanted himself, he said the hour's coming when you will worship God in spirit and in truth, for God's a spirit and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and truth, John 4 verse 24. Jesus in Luke 10 21 rejoiced in the spirit. Somebody say, Jesus danced and praised God the Father for 60 minutes, 1 hour straight. And you think, man, they sing too much, man, they have church too long. He hadn't even started preaching yet. Somebody say he praised God. Amen. Right by his lonesome, right by himself. And somebody say he did it in the spirit. Based on this revelation, not that demons are subject unto me, not that God answers every prayer when I pray it when I want it answered, but because my name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and he didn't need his name written there. He's the one that writes it. He was dancing and shouting and praising, Luke 10, 21, in the spirit. Somebody say, in the spirit. In spirit and truth. You know where that type of worship is? And if you ever get there, no preacher has to tell you to praise him. The reason preachers have to tell people, open their mouth, praise him, stand up, all the calisthenics of modern lukewarm Christianity. So I have to tell you everything to do, because you ain't in the spirit. And you ain't in the spirit until you remember, amen, what he did for you at your well. Come on, somebody. Jesus said your name is written in the book of life. And then he started rejoicing in the spirit. The moment you forget, amen, what he did for your soul and how now you've been redeemed. Not only from sin and the world and the bondages of the darkness of this time that's present, but I'm talking about an eternal world that's separated from God. When you lose sight of that, you'll stay stare with a glare from your chair and you won't know what to do, and you'll need somebody to tell you the simplest, come on somebody, though fundamental, amen, praise God, some of the most, amen, praise God, baby steps that we already know to take, the foundations of it. Somebody say, when he said, enter into my gates with thanksgiving, into my courts with praise, and be thankful unto me, Psalms 100 verse 4, that don't mean walk in, sit down. Come on somebody, that means walk in with praise on your lips, giving him glory and honor. Somebody say, if you in the spirit, that's what you'll do. But most of the time, folks on Sunday mornings in a rush, they didn't get up late to go to work, but they got up late to go to church. And we blaming the devil for all that's happening on our way to church, when it's our flesh most of the time, because we weren't prepared. Somebody say, in the spirit. Hello.
Why'd I act like I do, sound like I do, and offend you like I do? Because when I come in here, I have spent hours before I come in here in the spirit. And when I come in the spirit, I am going to offend your carnal mind every time. The only way I'm going to get along with carnal mindedness is if I come in here with a carnal mind. Anybody hear the Holy Ghost? Somebody say these are the elementary things. We should be being teachers by now. Amen. Hebrews 6 talks about, but yet we still have to be taught the very fundamental foundation, the beginning. Somebody say it's time to graduate kindergarten. Some folks ain't never got out of kindergarten. No wonder we can't win many to the Lord, birth many into the kingdom. We still in kindergarten. We still need a teacher to tell us when we should be being the teacher now. We should be teaching people. We should be teaching people who don't know the Lord. When they walk in, they look at us and say, my God, what's wrong with them? Look at them. What have they got? I need me what they got. But yet we acting like the world, most of us, when we come in. We don't look no different than somebody that's unconverted. Y'all remember how it used to be when you was lost? Hey, man, you acting like that again when you sitting in church. Man, you sit there and you didn't know. Amen. Some of us are looking like that again because we backsliding is what we're doing. That's why you can't shout like you used to shout. That's why you can't move and you got to be told to do everything. Because a backslider in his heart's filled with his own ways. Proverbs 14:14. Somebody say he's still in the spirit. Y'all hear that? I hear that carnal mind grinding. Hallelujah. Praise God. I'd love to come in here and just be able to preach and not rebuke saints. Rebuke carnal minded saints. Didn't know better. Didn't know what to do. Hello? Y'all ought to have been so loud in here this morning. I'm serious. When you walked in the door, you ought to have been heard giving him praise, especially when you hear a scripture spoke or somebody say something that's truth. How's it so hard to say? How's it so hard? I can tell you why it's so hard. You ain't in the spirit. You've not prepared your heart, and you have forgot what he did at this birthplace, at this place called the cross. Hallelujah. I ain't holding back to get you to come back. I'm going to let you have it while you're here, because some of you ain't going to get it nowhere else. Hello? Anybody hear the Holy Ghost? It is time to get out of kindergarten. Some of you ought to already be in the college of the spirit, but you still in grade school. Come on, these things ought not to be. You don't need a preacher being a praise coach. You don't need to hear a song sing and a favorite sound. I watch some people, they can't shout until they hear a song that they're familiar with, until they hear a lyric or a tune that they're familiar with that they really like and esteem high in respect. Somebody say you ought to be shouting just because of the cross. Amen. No other reason. But I think we've begun to learn how to live as far away from the cross and from the cross.